the cover-up was, I want to say, 6 total sessions.
The ink can hide the symbols of extremism, but the damage runs far deeper.
When he first came in and showed us the work that he had, I think everybody's jaw kind of hit the floor.
At Redemption Inc. in Colorado Springs, Dave Brown has covered more than 70 extremist or hate-inspired tattoos. More than 20, he estimates, were military, and he has a wait list of 635 people.
We have covered everything from portraits of the founding fathers of the KKK to swastikas. I've covered up a human trafficking branding.
The Army veteran camouflages the tattoos of hate for reformed extremists, but these ideologies and their symbols are still spreading in the military. Tattoos can be a calling card for white supremacists and extremists in the military, a way to grow their own ranks in secret amidst a nationwide surge in white nationalist activity. But according to a Department of Defense report on extremism obtained by CNN, some of the recruiting tactics are more brazen and more open. One example in the report, a military member and co-founder of the neo-Nazi group known as Atomwaffen Division told another member that he was open about everything with his friends at training. "They love me too, because I'm a funny guy," he wrote in a message. The Defense Department determined that others find each other through obscure fascist symbols on t-shirts or simply connect on social media and messaging apps. U.S. troops are primary targets for many extremist groups who want their training, their combat experience, and the legitimacy they bring to an organization. The report found that members of one far-right extremist group shared military manuals, including an Army manual on IEDs, improvised explosive devices, on the encrypted messaging app known as Telegram. The Capitol riots of January 6th put a spotlight on military extremism. A CNN analysis has shown that at least 27 people facing federal charges in connection with the riot are current or former members of the military. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin has made the fight against domestic extremism one of his top priorities.
This tears at the fabric, very fabric of cohesion, and it's important for us to be able to trust the men and women on our left and right.
Extremism has been a problem in the military for decades. Austin says he believes the number of extremists in the military is low, but there is no data to back up his assertion.
I know.
Austin has ordered a review of policies on extremism, but extremism expert Heidi Byrick says this will take time.
This is a massive management task, and it's not going to be something that's done very easily at all.
The military has strict legal limits on the screening and background checks it can do of applicants and service members. Deeper, more intrusive investigations require working with the FBI, a key recommendation of the DoD report. Byrick says the military needs a better screening process to root out extremism before it enters the ranks.
I would say you need to fix your screening procedures immediately. Social media accounts need to be taken a look at, not just voluntarily, but seriously. You need a functioning tattoo database for your recruiters, and they need to be trained in the signs of white supremacy.
Even beyond the challenges of rooting out domestic extremism within active ranks, there's the issue of veterans, more than 18 million of them, who are also prime targets for domestic extremists.
And Oren Liebermann joins me now. Oren, clearly this is a problem. We've seen current and former members of the military charged in connection with the January 6th Capitol riot. What's the Pentagon doing about it?
Well, the first big step for Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin is that military-wide review known as a stand down, and that will include not only a review of policies and procedures, the rules about extremism, but also discussions at all ranks of the military about the oaths of service, as well as the sort of the code and what's important to the military and the values here. That, he says, is only a first step. Crucially, that only addresses active duty. The question of what to do about veterans who find themselves with extremist ideologies or extremist ranks is a much more difficult question, because DoD can't do the same sort of monitoring, screening, investigations, or keeping track of veterans the same way it can do for active duty. Crucially, again, this all requires data. How widespread is the problem, and where does the problem exist? And that is fundamentally lacking at this point, John.